So we've explored in some detail in a trivial one-dimensional example, and then so we would like to do if that has increased enthusiasm, I'm not sure about it, but if it did, then the design maybe try to obtain a similar sort of algebra for more complicated things. Or more, yeah, so A is a ring that denies notation for out. Or further a shape of such algebras over some sort variety X. Some examples are immediate. So this is not, whether or not this is interesting, but this is not n. So for example, of course, beta gamma system can be defined in dimension. So there is no doubt we know what in this notation.
Then we could use some ways to beta gamma system. You know why it's called beta gamma system?
Physicists. I think that they just use the notation. You know, notationally their imagination is like, I think they just use betas and gammas and called, just like W algebras. Why W algebras are W algebras? Yes,
right.
You noted them, but.
No, I know, because of the value. Because of the value.
But not the Malochi. I don't think Zamolochikov invented the first.
He gave the name because of the one.
Oh, really?
Because of the one.
I thought it was just SL3.
In violence of the name? Of SL3 is a mother.
Perhaps, so, you know that. Okay. So there is some. For beta gamma, there is no reason whatsoever, I suspect. But in any case, we know what that means. It's I allow myself to be informal. So we simply have a bunch of fields, and we impose the commutation relations. That mimic as we've got used to thinking about it this way, that mimic the derivation operators. And so that of course as a space is a polynomial ring in infinitely many variables, it is graded. The subindex will stand for the conformal frame, we will discuss it in greater detail later on. And the further layers are all three modules of this polynomial ring. Here it becomes a little involved. This is still a subindex, etc. Now this allows an obvious generalization. So suppose, so what I want to say is A is a ring of functions over a sufficiently small open neighborhood of a point on a smooth affine variety. To remove the necessity to repeat all this, so we're referring to this as A being good. Precisely, this means the following. We will assume that there are elements. So in one word, there is a type, it has an type coordinate. Of course, algebraically, you typically, unless it's here, you don't expect to have an honest coordinate system. But locally, there are Atari coordinate systems. And what that means is, so it's an N tuple of functions such that there are differentials with a free basis. So the differentials form a free basis of the space of scalar differentials. If so, then you.
You mean omega 1?
Yeah, when I write omega a sub a, I always mean omega 1. It means that there are those DVX. So in this case, they have to be defined not as, you know, as limits of the change over run, but rather as derivations, basis due to dx. So dxi evaluated on probability at g is delta ij. This implies at once that dxi is an abelian basis of the A module of derivations. Abelian, of course, means that the Lie-Brackett range is.
Do you assume that xi is a generator of A?
Say again?
Do you assume that xi is a generator?
Not only I don't assume it, they aren't. That's the difference.
Ah, then.
They generate the how to call. So the whole thing is a finite extension of the polynomial set ring. And so do these conditions. But if so, then you can define this algebra for such an A by simply tensoring this whole thing with A over this polynomial ring, because thanks to coordinates, this thing acts here and the tensor product. So the picture for this thing is always like the thing above, except that we have extended the coordinate ring from polynomials to the entire A. But otherwise, the basis is the same. And this thing is about itself. So those fields are as before. So the crucial thing is to define a field associated to an element of the ring. And for that, I will use that formal Taylor series expansion that I have already used in the dimension one case, remember? So I will simply write, let me write first the formula informally, and then I'll show you a one-dimensional case, and then you will, of course, no doubt see what is it that I mean. So I think of this as informally, like A, where instead of A of X, I have X naught plus delta x of z, and in fact there is a superindex and stuff. So, but informally explaining this form, or rather informally explaining, I don't know, formal or informal was better, explaining it as a Taylor series, you will get something like remember the Hertel's coordinate, so you can apply to A. Whereas derivatives, I'll put it this way, maybe d1, d2, etc., so n selector divided by something like, I'm just thinking of a higher dimensional Taylor formula. So that's an element of A times this thing. It's many indices, so I'll write something like that. The meaning of this should be clear. If the dimension is 1, then of course what I mean simply is.
Yeah, just usual Taylor.
Usual Taylor formula. So sub A dx to the n divided by n squared, and then this sub as I is different from 0, x sub I is equal to minus I to the n. So that's what I'm doing. Of course, there is an obvious analog of this. Ah, n is not good. J. And then a simple exercise in the spirit of various exercises suggested last time. You will easily verify the following draft.
Also, you probably should evaluate the x0 j, because what's there from you take derivative to evaluate it.
Yeah, but it's hidden here. It's I can say a of x0, but that's what I mean. It's just an element of a. Just a function evaluated. So it's just the same thing as when I previously wrote f of x0, it was really this in all depth. Think about it, it's just that's it for now. So the result will be exactly as you would expect. You take A, there is this derivation, the field associated to equal over rules, and then delta D minus delta.
We say what kind of algebraic varieties have probably open subsets in the affine space? Or is there other?
No, open affine, it's an arbitrary fine variety, but smooth. A sufficiently small neighborhood where an entire coordinate system exists. That's the range of rings that.
So any smooth affine variety?
Open subset. Yeah, sufficiently small open subset of any smooth affine variety.
Right.
So locally, such thing can be easily defined. That's what I'm saying.
It is not only open subsets in the affine space.
Not only a subset of an affine space. An open subset of any affine variety. Sufficiently small. You just need that, and that really is important for future classification problem. What really is important is the abelian basis of the module derivation. That's what's crucial. Once you have this, you can proceed by this formula. And so the extension theorem, these are generating things, and the extension theorem implies that there is a unique property of this. And thus defined.
Is it clear that in around smooth point, you can choose
a type coordinate system.
Such as
yes. This is where any textbook on the module starts.
It's not complicated.
Hmm?
It's not complicated. You can choose commuting vector.
That they commute immediately follows that this is a dual basis to the. If you have functions whose differentials is a basis of. The cotangent shift, then the dual basis of derivation is automatically commutative because of that formula. When you bracket of dxi and xj is exactly the value of dxj on dxi. So if your vector field, you see, that's by definition. So this immediately implies that, so this implies that the brackets, Lie brackets of such vector fields vanish on the coordinate function. The functions don't generate the entire ring, but they generate the entire ring up to a finite extension. If, and so if brackets vanish on this C of x, then the derivation is uniquely determined by the values on C of x, because the other functions are all algebraic over this. That's how this is. Right? All right, so the question I would like to ask is there something else? And the answer is yes, there is, and this is the whole point. There is something else. And that gives rise to some interesting examples. But what is there? So, now I'm starting to...
Doesn't on any algebraic variety, you can cover some by such affine charts and some to look adjacent.
And that, the gluing is where the problem lies. Gluing is hard.
There are some abstract.
Even if you do it like this, you may fail. But there is a more involved such algebras. And even with them, you can fail. But the ultimate result is, like what you said, applied to algebras slightly more complicated than to the one I just described. So that's where I'm headed. So I will, from now on, I'll spend quite some time talking on the passage from vertex algebras to vertex algebraics. This is an analog, probably I should remind you. So vertex algebraics play R for yet to be defined algebras of Carroll strings of operators. What Lie algebraoids, or as I call them, become Lie algebraoids for algebras of twisted differential operators. So we discuss Lie algebraoids and how they can be used to construct algebras of twisted differential operators. So here, since more complicated, I'm starting from the passage in the opposite direction. So we would like to understand what that is and then see how you can travel backwards to define an algebra of Carroll differential operators. And from this point on, I will be talking about a series of papers by Kurbanovs, Shetland, and myself. So first of all, what I will understand by vertex algebra, of course, what Victor explained, but the language I will be using, the most convenient language for me, will be that of not so much of a formal series, but rather of various multiplications. So I will think of a vertex algebra as a collection of lots of different things. So one is a specific element, the vacuum. It may have denoted it like this. D is what I previously denoted as T. So this is a canonical derivation. Of course, I'm running a risk of having this confused with various. I also have derivations along the target space. I hope I will avoid the clash of negation. And finally, M are those parts. And the fields are, of course, say if A is an element, then the corresponding field is A. the generating series of the endomorphisms given by
multiplication. Exactly.
Yeah, of course, the same definition. It's just that I will never be using, almost never be using this, but I will rather be using those plus the Borchers identity or some very specific, very special particular cases. That's what I mean. Of course, it's the same.
And this was actually our second definition.
Of course. So, my focus, vertex algebraids, yes, another thing that will be very important for me is that we will be conformally graded. Meaning that there is a direct sum to composition, positively related subspaces, and that agrees with the multiplications, if I'm not terribly mistaken, like this. And the idea would be to focus on the first two subspaces. By the way, of course, it's advisable to keep in mind that example. So the node is, in my previous example, is exactly at the ring. And V1 was a direct sum. So there will be basis elements of two types, x's and the derivatives. And this is something that will be, this presentation will find in a second place in the general theory and generalized. So I will start with the facts that are to be found on the very first pages of any modern textbook on vertex algebras. Probably I should, the time flies, lest we lose orientation. So let me give you an overview of what I want to derive. I'll spend quite some time, but the result is easy to visualize. So this thing, I'm claiming that in general, V0 plus V1 is something very specific. So V0 is arithmetically a ring of the type I've considered, and V1 fits an exact sequence.
So the zero is coming to the source of the unit of
alpha. Yeah. Well, this is what I'll forgive all for the formulation. Yes, A is a ring of the type of the star. So this will always be for any reality. This is automatically a link in algebraic. Typical example would be T is derivations of A. And that will be my focus. But in general, it's just an object of the kind I consider. It's a Lie algebra and an A module, and it also has a Lie algebra and A module homomorphism. To the algebraic of derivations of it. Omega is, in the main example, it's not necessarily the space of one form, but it will be assumed to be so. in the situation when I will give you the classification result. But otherwise, it's a module that formally has formal properties of the module of one difference.
So this is A module.
Yes, so this will be an A module, and this V algebra will act on it by a Lie derivative. It will be exactly the classic Lie derivative in the case that it's the module of one forms. But in more general situation, something like this will also be defined. And finally, I had this derivation D. It acts like this. And its restriction to A is exactly as you would expect the round differential. No, it's a round differential only in this case. So it's a derivation in general, but in this case, that will coincide with the Durand difference. So this is an overview. That's what I'm headed towards. And of course, this what you should keep in mind is a similar discussion in the case of algebras of differential operators. We had something like this. It's very similar, but you will notice that the crucial difference is that functions have been replaced by one form, so this gives some kind of an increase in dimension, and that's the hallmark of this passage from
this was called the Liplica.
Yeah. So that's why I spend time on that, because the discussion now will be very similar, but more involved. And the result is analogous, but different. Are there any questions? Okay. So, as I said, the very first step here is to be found at the beginning of any modern textbook. You will notice that the triple denotes multiplication number minus one, and the vacuum, by the way, it's part of, I guess, part of the definition of the conformal gradient, I suspect, that the vacuum is part of, belongs to the denote. As promised, is a unit cell. The vacuum is the unit, commutative, associative, algebra. So, of course, that's part of the definition that, and that's a test of my notation, of my definition there. So if J is minus one, then indeed, the product of the node with itself belongs to the node, so this is a product. Why is it commutative? That follows not so much from the Borchardt identity, but rather, as Victor explained, from a skew symmetry. There are, of course, corrections, but they all vanish for dimensional reasons. So the next term will be what? Be a 0, a, and that if existed, it would belong to be minus 1, it's not there. So this is 0 for dimensional reasons. You don't need to compute anything. So that's commutativity. As to associativity, you have to compare this with A minus 1, B minus 1. This is an honest, perhaps one of the most important Borchardt identities, also known as normal order. It contains the term one bonds, but it contains plenty of other terms. What the other terms? So, in general, of course, this product is not associative, but if you restrict to the node, then for the same reason as above, all these will disappear, and immediately associate. All right. Now let's move on. Move on being going over to the above. So the one is closed under the zero. Well, as far as the one goes, of course, we have two things. Yeah, so from now on, instead of this annoying V note, I will be writing A. So you know this closed under A node, but it, so there are two things as far as the one goes. So A wants to act on the one, at least there is this map. And the one is some kind of an algebra with respect to the zero operation. But there is this map, but the formula I just wrote shows that this map doesn't give the one a an A model structure. So the one is not an A module. Of course, associativity is violated. But we'll talk about expressions like this soon. This doesn't have to be zero, but that part, by the way, is pretty much under control. Nevertheless, there is this map, but there is also a map I mentioned from A to B1. And this map is a derivation, simply meaning that D of, well, if you know what, A minus 1, D plus A minus 1. Maybe. So now form A times meaning just I will sometimes omit the note and will sometimes write a thing like this, of course meaning the product number minus one. You immediately verify that the restriction of that map to the subspace makes it
zero square.
No. Minus first.
Minus
A operator minus one is like multiplication for A. So A attempts to act elsewhere using my minus one. Zero of course will give you a zero here. And makes A and A mod. And that's the beginning of that's the beginning of that exact sequence. Omega, I will soon introduce this notation, will stand exactly for ADA. The fact that this is an A module is very simple, but it's not empty. So, so you do have to verify. This as it's in principle, this would I should have spawned that, so I should have written A times DA, but the associativity, you will immediately verify that if you have an element like this and multiply it by A, then it's the same as this. All right, now let's investigate this operator. Minus 1, of course, doesn't give the vertex algebra an associated commutative algebra structure, but it's an attempt of being such. Likewise, zeroth operation is an approximation to zero operation, is an approximation to this structure. So, I think technical statement, if I'm not terribly mistaken, is that this pair is a Leibniz algebra. Although I will never need the statement. What I mean simply is an obvious one of the more important particular cases of the Borchers identity. That, of course, is just the statement that zeroth operation is a derivation of, in particular, of a zeroth problem. But when written like this, this is a form of Jacobi identity. And Leibniz algebra is an algebra with an operation where this version of the Jacobi identity holds. Commutativity, of course, fails. That's the skew symmetry. All other terms vanish for dimensional rhythm. as to this, again, by dimensional argument will show that this is an element of A. And so, of course, anti-symmetry fails, but holds. Modulo my A D A. So let me denote by omega A D A. And so what V is to show is that V1 mod out omega is a real. Second, the map that we discussed. Preserves satisfies minus 1 omega belongs. That of course is a is banal by definition. And so defines a map. Like this, which gives my algebra. Do you want me to verify this? It really is this associativity violated exactly in the term that's there. And so if you wash this out, then of course. What else? There is one more operator. At least I will discuss two more. And in particular, I will get to a classical content of yet another operation. So in addition to all of this, the zero operation gives you a map like this. I mean, zeroth product with an element of conformal weight 1 always preserves the conformal weight, in particular, it preserves A. And it, of course, satisfies, as you can easily check, that elements from omega operate by 0 on A. And so this makes A becomes a module over this Lie algebra. It's also very easy. It has been proved more or less. Should you like to think about it? Furthermore, but the thing I'm going to say now, how does this Lie algebra act on A? I should have said that anybody except with that. So furthermore, V1 mod out omega acts by derivation. The reason for that is even simpler. Acts, of course, by means of the zeroth operation. But zeroth operation is a derivation on the totality of the vector theorem. So this is obvious. So I have erased my preview, but we've got most of it. So now I will be so brave as to denote by T this quotient. So what we've discussed is can be a considerable part of it can be summed up by saying that T is a Lie algebra. That is to say, it's a Lie algebra. It's a name module, and you can easily verify that. For example, if you let consider psi eta elements of T and A an element of A, then you can verify that classically I would say the bracket, but here I will write the zero operation of between psi and some other vector field, then of course zero being the derivation, you will get the value of psi on A times eta plus. That, of course, part of the definition of Lie operators we discussed previously. In this context, it follows from the zero operation being a derivation. So, formally, being a Lie algebraic means that there is a morphism of Lie algebras and their modules like this. And this morphism, of course, simply given by the action on A. All right. I haven't yet given you any substantial reason for denoting by omega, keeping in mind the one forms, of course, this module ADA. So let me discuss that. What is it that omega has in common with one forms? So returning to this exact sequence, the one is closed under the zero operation. This is not a Lie algebra. Nevertheless, this is an idea. And so this implies that, so to say, a joint action of the one on itself gives rise.
Ideal with respect to zero square.
Yeah, so it gives rise to the T action on omega. And again, we use the fact that zero's multiplication is a derivation of all products to see that the section is exactly as we are taught in differential geometry. Psi applies to A dV will be psi applied to A plus A times psi applied to dV. But of course, the derivative, this canonical derivation, can be used for the zero's operation. And you will have plus d psi applied to d. And of course, exactly how the Lie derivative is defined. So, were these actual vector fields, were t an algebra vector field and omega the module of Keller differential, then it would get a definition of the Lie derivative. And this is what, in general, the same formula applies. I will temporarily write Lie derivative in quotation marks, but in the situation of interest, it will be an honest omega will be Keller differentials, and this will be an actual Lie derivative. And the last of the operations, the vertex operation that have a purely classic contact. Can you guess which one?
Contact.
Operation number one. So,
so you can say only three operations. Minus one, zero, and one.
Yeah, we'll talk about. I have considered practically. So, this thing. So, the whole thing is that carries infinitely many operations. This space is closed under all positive operations. The rest are all zero. That's the only non-trivial one. Those restricted to the subspace are all equal to zero. And it has partially defined minus one, usually in the form, always in the form function times something else, and D. D appears only when restricted to A, otherwise it's inapplicable. So one, there is of course one in this context, appears as this pair. And one is a tricky thing. Part of it really brings us to the essence of what's happening, abstractions and things like that. And but part of it is completely classic. You will observe that of course, omega 1, omega E0, A, omega 1, just omega, that's the indication, etc. So we can apply further elements of D and then D squared of A, things like that. They form a commutative vertex subalgebra of the whole thing. So this is just the beginning of a certain subalgebra. And of course, elements commute with themselves. So this is zero, which means that I get this map defines me a pairing. I will denote it by this A1 between vector fields, so to say, and one. And now you could perhaps immediately guess what that is. It's just the contraction, the substitution of a. Well, in the case when this is vector field and this is forms. That is simply the evaluation of a form. Evaluation of a one form in a vector field. In general, as again, commutation relations will show you once, the value on alleged vector field and alleged form will be. This. So again, in the classic situation, that's just a db evaluated on set. From this point of view, and a little bit for those interested, you can, an exercise for the interested, see what all of this. So there are actually, so any vertex algebra in conforming way 0 and 1 has all this structure. See exactly what all this means in our simplest example. You should be able easily to compute all such things and see that omega is exactly one forms and t is exactly derivations. And you'll be able to compute all the other operations. In particular, part of it will be given by some degree to differential operators. This is non-classical. So we have an example of all of this. The question that the real question that I would like to address is what else is there? I guess it's exactly a convenient time to make a break, but then I will continue. So back to this question, what else is there? I suppose fixed vertex algebra satisfying those conditions so that the first floors of it are K and this extension.
And so, and this is driven by non-negative integers.
Yeah, yes, I wanted to say, Victor called this introduced conformal weight, and then said vertex algebra graded by conformal weight. When I say conformal graded vertex algebra, I mean exactly the same thing, except that I typically don't use any Virasoro or Hamiltonian operator. But of course, if you have a grading, you can define an operator that multiplies the component.
No, grading is exactly a given space of Hamiltonian energy.
Yeah, of course. All right, so suppose we have such a thing. Now the question will be, what other things like that look like? Let me make this slightly.
So you're now axiomatizing?
Not yet. Axiomatizing is kind of painful and misleading. Instead, I want to do some nice, concrete vertex algebra computation. This is really the subject of today's class. I wanted to use the vertex algebra axioms and derive some nice, see how they translate into some nice geometric computations. And then I will try to axiomatize. So I'll try to proceed as if I were a physicist. So at the moment it's pretty well defined. So suppose I have one such algebra, we've seen such algebras. I will assume that these two fixed. I will, even although this will never be important, this will be important, but not now. So that this is actually one form, and this is actually derivation. It's just psychologically simpler, but otherwise it's not very important, not at the moment. And the last thing I will do is I will assume that this sequence splits. I will fix a split. So, for example,
it is not always true for any value.
Well, over complex numbers, you can always split, but these are infinite, huge.
No, split. They measure.
Yeah. This is what it's not. Yes, you cannot always do. But for example, if these two are free, then you can easily split. So omega is, of course, there as to tau, you can write it as the sum of a minus 1 sum I psi I, where psi 1, etc. Psi n is the basis. And then you will have a split.
At a basis.
Hmm?
A.
Yes, a basis.
Okay.
A. All right. One other thing. So the most peculiar of the products there is one number is the one that goes under name number one. So I will also assume fixed the restriction of one on the derivation. I will not be doing anything. So what freedom is there? Almost nothing. The room for maneuver then simply is the operation number 0 from here as product of elements of vector fields. In principle, this operation has two components. It preserves conformal weight one, so two components, here and there. And by definition, this component is also fixed. It equals Galois bracket, as we discussed. That's part of the assumption. So the room for maneuver is this one. So keep in mind, the algebra I started with a good ring. And there you can actually compute everything. And you will see that the formula for zeroth component in this ring is rather involved. It's some bidifferential operator in coefficients of the two arguments. This is an exercise. So what else can there be? Well, it's clear that this component can be read. So we will now introduce
but also it depends on the splitting.
Yeah, but we will see the splitting. The effect of the splitting will be discussed later. So introduce, so to say, the new zeros. So what I said is summarized by saying that the new zeroth product of two vector fields is the old one plus element there, I will call it alpha, and this depends on psi and a. I will soon be computing various expressions, and to an expression like this, I will oftentimes refer as old stuff. All right, so what can we say about alpha? So alpha is an element of omega A. So alpha psi eta for each psi and eta defines a map from the relations to A. Just one form, so psi goes to psi has been given to N. Epsilon goes to the value of this one form on epsilon. So the whole thing then becomes a function of three variables. Alpha defines a map like this. For this reason, instead of writing alpha psi eta, I will write alpha of psi eta dot, meaning that this, in fact, is a function of three variables. Lemma. As a function of three variables, alpha is a closed three form.
Alpha psi eta for fixed, say, eta defines
bracket of two vector fields gives you a vector field plus 1,4. So I started by saying that f of psi 8 is this 1,4. 1,4 defines a function. So now it's because it also depends on psi and eta, we have a function of 3 values. Therefore, an upper index. Lemon says that it's not just any map, it's in fact a closed 3,4. So the statement means the following three claims: that alpha is a linear, that it is totally anti-symmetric. B is to say that alpha is a spiral. And finally, it's closed. And all of this follows from various axioms of Gottesdorf, but typically from Borchers identities and from time to time from skew symmetry. So for example, I guess A linearity is the easiest. So compute. So I will derive A linearity modulo 2. Then I will 2. Unless you get tired of a little test. I can skip some of the arguments. We will see. So why alpha is a linear, so compute the zero product, the new zero product with this is fixed. We are not doing anything to anything else. So what is that? So first of all, it's the old bracket of this S plus this extra thing out of psi A eta. On the other hand, you can use the commutator formula. It was A minus 1. So plus the bracket of this multiplication and this. So you will have to use the commutator formula. You know, of course, what I mean. Particular case will be greatly simplified. There will be only one more term. Psi naught, and psi naught has been changed. And in any case, psi naught on A, that's part of the structure. Not only it has been changed in this computation, but it will never be changed. It's part of what we have fixed once and for all. That's classical. Vector fields operating on functions. So this, and then part of this is the same. It's expressed in terms of expressed in terms of things that are fixed once and for all. The novelty, of course, comes from alpha appearing in this computation. So this is all, again, old, plus exactly what we want. A minus 1 alpha of psi eta. And so just focusing on what's new, locked in linearity. And all computations are like that, except that at some point they become much more involved. How do you feel about this? Do you want me to go over all of them or part of them? By far the most interesting, of course, is the closedness. Probably, Victor, say, tell me, what would you like me to do?
I think that next time I'll give an exercise to derive all this from formulas that I'm going to write next. But I didn't check myself, so but I said I think it should be.
So shall we skip some? Let me say a few words about, so total anti-symmetricity, let me leave it out. With what I've shown, linearity with respect to the second argument in alpha. If you have total anti-symmetricity, then of course it's linear with respect to all arguments. So let me completely skip the verification of anti-symmetricity. And if some of you will be upset, I will next time perhaps do that. But instead, let me tell you a few words about closedness. That's perhaps the most exciting. Use this word in this context at all, the most exciting part of the entire business. So by cloud, closed is the consequence of an object's perfect algebra identity that I have already mentioned once, and that's this simple identity, thanks to which T is a the algebra is of course the one that plays the central role in all of this. So why closed? So one has to compute psi eta theta. Eta psi zeta, and finally psi zeta eta zero zeta. So what kind of and so the result is, of course, that if you add, take this, subtract this, and then subtract this, then the result is zero. The most interesting term here will be, will take value in 1/4. So, for example, let me write, let me compute the first such expression. So, modulo 1/4, this is a good old bracket of vector fields. Bracket of vector fields in the vortex context, I keep repeating, is much more complicated, even in one-dimensional situation, if you compute what I would denote something like this. Then, of course, modulo 1/4, you will have the familiar expression f g phi minus f prime g d, no doubt about it. But there will be a rather annoying extra term that owes its existence to the double pairings in the computation of OP by the Wick field. So there is something else there. But this something else is due only to what I call old stuff. It's all made out of the way a vector field, our alleged vector field, it's not canonical a vector field, but this thing acts on functions canonically as the usual vector field. And only such terms contribute to a bracket like this. So there will be something else, which is totally independent of the choice of my zero operation, which I will skip. Then there will be terms that involve things that really depend on the choice. So, psi, for example, here, we will have something like psi applied to alpha, beta, zeta. That was my notation. So, this means, so this term came from this graph. That's the novelty, to which I then apply psi by means of the zeros product. And then there will be another term that also a novelty and comes from the last zeros product. That, of course, is alpha of psi. And then that's why I wrote that. So the usual bracket. These lines give similar expressions with those three fellows, psi, eta, and zeta, cyclically permuted. So, in the end of the day, much of this stuff automatically cancels out. For example, the Jacobi identity will lead to this thing going up. What we have to verify is that the terms containing alpha will go away. What's the easiest to do that? You have to realize that this is not a function. And this operation is not a derivative of a function. This is a bound form. And this is a Lie derivative. So in order to get down to actual derivatives of functions, what you have to do is to evaluate, in the end of the day, a form you get on an arbitrary vector. So what you will have to do is, for each expression like this, evaluate it on some other vector field, which in the vertex algebraic language means apply epsilon 1 first product with epsilon to all those results. Again, there will be first product leads to lots of things that are fixed and have no control over them. We will only focus on the terms that involve alpha. So what you have to verify, well, you have this condition that this, all this evaluated on arbitrary psi, eta, zeta, and epsilon gives zero if you add this, subtract this, and subtract that. What does this amount to? Well, now it's more or less, well, almost done. The terms containing alpha are all here. The only thing is we have to do something about this epsilon 1. So, for example, here, well, epsilon 1 applied to this is, as we discussed, that's just a contraction. So that will give me alpha psi eta zeta epsilon. And which line will have the term of the step? More interesting computation is this one, where we apply epsilon 1 to the result of the derivative along set. Well, we like to evaluate epsilon 1 when applied to the form itself, so we swap them. And epsilon 1 on that is, of course, just the value.
So it's very difficult to see with this
red. I wanted to impress you on my pedagogical devices, and you won't let me. Okay.
At least I can see it, but younger people probably not
see it. I enjoy it.
You can.
You can see.
Now it's in zero, huh? delta A. So we are computing this. I swap, and the result is psi naught epsilon plugged in there. Alpha eta theta epsilon. That's one term, but there is another when I bracket. Bracketing these things gives rise by the Borchardt's commutator formula to, you know, epsilon zero psi number one. If this is number one, then that becomes it goes away, I believe. But as to this, the result will be just the value of alpha, eta, theta, and then here I plot the bracket. Epsilon. So each line gives me one expression of this type, where I simply have a function and I differentiate it along a vector space. That's an expression of type one. And two elements with God knows what signs of this type, where alpha is not differentiated, but it is evaluated on. Yeah, here it is. At that point, I was still using my pedagogical device. This or this, not this. So, and two elements of this type, where alpha is simply evaluated on two initial vectors and a bracket of the other initial vectors. So all in all, you will have, with appropriate signs, you will have four elements of the type one vector field applied to the value of alpha on three other vector fields, and six elements of the type like this. For example, when alpha is simply evaluated, it's not differentiated along anything, evaluated on three vectors. One of them is the bracket of two, and two more are just arguments. So what is it that we want to prove? We want to prove that this equals d alpha on psi, eta, zeta, and epsilon. But d is the wrong differential. Now you just have to remember or learn the formula for the wrong differential of a straight form. It has exactly that structure. You either take one of those vectors out and differentiate the value of the form on the remaining three vectors. And depending on what vector is taken out, sign changes or doesn't, it flashes. Or you pick all the pairs, for example, psi eta, bracket, and keep the rest as they are. If I'm not terribly mistaken, this should come with a minus, and then the sum of the signs start flashing. How many terms like this are there? Well, four choose two. I believe six. So both computations, the vertex one and the round one, have the same structure. I leave the unenviable task of verifying the science to the interested listener. But the point is that the vortex computation reproduces exactly the formula for the Durand differential, and that proves that alpha must be closed. Any questions? All right. Next. The next problem in formula deals exactly with the question Victor raised. What if we choose a different splitting? Perhaps the more refined form is, suppose we've got a new vortex algebra like this. I haven't proved that we've got. I just showed that if you try to define a vortex algebra in this way, then the only thing you can do is add a closed free form. So suppose you have found such a. So suppose now we have this. We started under the assumption that there is a V. Now we've shown that V. The best we can hope for is for a closed three for alpha, we can define some other vertex. I will denote it like this. It's different from V, as I said, only in that the zero product of two vector fields has been changed by the value of alpha on the pair of those vector fields. And suppose there is a vertex algebra like this. If there is, it's essentially unique. Remember, the rest of the classic structure, omega A, tau A, and parts of the operations that are classic, are fixed. Suppose now we have two such algebras. Now that's the most we can have. Suppose we have two of them. The question is, what's the space of homomorphisms? From one to another. Not exactly in the category of vertex algebras. I will tell you. It's like I did previously. So what can we do without violating what's given to us? So again, we are given that whatever we have fits this exact sequence. And part of the vortex algebra structure that's classical is given by classical formulas such as weight derivative and singularity. So how can, suppose we have two such things, one and another. How can one be mapped into another? Well, of course, modulo omega, these are identical. Omega itself is also fixed once and for all. We don't have any room for maneuver. So whatever map we have should fit this, make this diagram commutative. All of this was much better said because it was much clearer in the situation of Picard, Lee, algebraics. So this thing could be easily defined. I haven't even defined such thing, but I just explored some of the properties they necessarily have. But there, that was exactly the line of the chain of thought. So things like that are matched into each other so that the corresponding vector spaces are mapped identically. So the same thing must be valid here, and therefore the only possibility is essentially the change of the splitting. That is to say, map from one to another, a map from one to another, is determined by essentially changing the splitting. So vector field should go to itself plus beta of psi. Beta of psi, like alpha of psi eta being an element of omega 1, here beta of psi must be an element of omega 1. And just as before, we think of beta as beta of two variables, simply because omega itself defines a map of vector field. So beta defines in the same way as before a map from Pa cross Pa to A. And therefore, we will be writing, instead of beta psi being an element of omega A, we will write beta a function of two variables with values in it. You, of course, see what I'm about to say. So there is a companion lemma to the previous one. So if F is amorphous, by the way, it is automatically an isomorph because it's an identity on the gradient space. It's an identity on omega, it's an identity on the quotient by omega. Therefore, if there is such a category, well, there is, because we know examples that it's local. If there is, it's automatically a groupoid. Homomorphism or isomorphism. But in any case, F is an isomorphism implies beta. So F of psi is defined to be psi plus beta of psi. So this implies that beta is to form such that, can you guess? I didn't say, so F, if F is a morphism from V plus L to 1 to V plus L to 2, F of psi is psi plus beta of psi. So then beta is a two form such that the d of beta is plus or minus alpha 1 minus alpha 2. So these are closed free forms, so they may or may not be, the difference may or may not be exact. If it is exact, then there is a chance of having a morphism, and it is this. You should choose beta so that the beta is the difference. So why is that so? Of course, this is an analogy of easily explained statement in the context of Picardly algebraic. There it was like this. You change the splitting, and so psi goes to alpha of psi, so that alpha here is one, so the value is then a function. the bracket could have been twisted by a closed two form, and you can untwist it by using a bound form, so that the closed form is the boundary, co-boundary of the bound. It's the same here. But again, notice that the dimension, though, dimension has gone up by one. This again is almost run out of time, so I don't really. Let me. So the lemma consists in verifying that beta must be anti-symmetric and alinear in both arguments. And then being homomorphic means this. Let me say a few words about this most interesting part, and that will be the end. If I can change, if I can find the page. So what is it that I have to verify? I have to verify, I have to find out what the, if it's a homomorphism, it must preserve the products, in particular the zeros products. So this must be equal to this. And so you just compute. So what does this equal? What's this? That equals psi plus beta psi. That eta plus beta theta. Now you'll have to compute the zeros operation between these two. And again, some of the terms will be common to any such vertex algebra, depending or not on alpha. And some of the terms will be actually interesting. So of course there will be psi eta, but that's common. It will cancel against a similar computation there. So what will actually be interesting is beta psi zero product with eta, plus a similar expression psi zero beta, plus a term that depends on alpha, that comes from the zeroth operation of psi and eta. This all unfolds in the target, so that's alpha 2 of psi and eta. Eta, no, this is a one from, so that's my way of denoting such things. And a similar expression can be written here, so inside of the source, it's the bracket plus some other term, the non-trivial part is the value of alpha 1. And then this whole thing goes to, we know where will it go, the same thing. So the interesting terms are one form. On the one form, f acts as a constant. So alpha 1 psi beta plus the beta that needs this, although this is common to any such computation, I could not simulate this term because it enters my beta. So I need to compare the two things. And the way to do it is, of course, straightforward. The snag here is that this is not a bracket of this. This is not the action of a vector field on a function. This is a bound form, so this is a weak derivative. So just as before, I should give myself a third vector field and evaluate both sides. Say zeta. Apply arbitrary zeta 1 by means of product number 1 to both sides. And when you do it carefully, you will have exactly what's claimed. So alpha 1 minus alpha 2 evaluated on psi eta zeta. And then you will have to recall the formula for the differential over 2 form. So d beta of psi eta zeta is given by similar expressions. Psi beta eta theta. Two more terms like this, when one of them is taken out. And three terms where two of them are brackets. And the third is taken as it is, as an argument. Of course, this computation is of the same shape. And again, the task is to verify the signs, and they all go inside. And that proves the sign. So, in a sense, if you give yourself time to think about it, you will see that we practically proved, so to say, the fact that all such things are labeled by elements of the space of closed three forms, and morphisms are given by two forms, so that three forms are related by morphisms if and only if their distance is exact. The only problem with it is that, so we have classified something, all such things are classified, but I haven't denoted what such things are. So my the thing I will start next time, which I'm afraid is tomorrow, I will define those objects, and then we will very easily see that this computation classifies those objects.
So they are labeled by H3.
Yes, they are labeled by the elements of the omega 3 closed, and the pairs are isomorphic if and only if the corresponding, the difference between corresponding closed forms is exact, and then each form that whose co-boundary is this distance gives you an isomorphic. So this gives the category of things that I haven't yet defined, this kind of torsor structure. Torsor over sort of the space of closed three forms. I will make all of this precise. But if you go over these computations, you feel like doing so, you will see that they are actually easily invertible. If you think a little bit about it, you will convince yourself very easily that all these arguments can be inverted and give rise to a classification of all such objects. I will make this discussion next time.
So, okay, so in other words, you classify vectors.
So I will call such things, what I should just call such vectors. Things, such things will be called essentially vertex algebraids. And I will say that locally they are classified like this. And then we will have this gives rise easily, not so easily, but rather in a straightforward manner, this gives rise to classification of such things on any smooth variety. In particular, we will see that they exist only if abstraction, there is a certain chronological abstraction to existence of shapes globally.
So you construct these two?
Yes, I will construct if they exist. So I will say when, I will find out when they exist, and if they exist, I will construct all of them.
Okay. So under certain topologies, if attachments vanish, then it puts it on this manifold. There exists kind of algebra.
Yes, and then I will classify the isomorphic class.
And not only one, but this.
Yeah, a certain cohomology group, special kind of cohomology group, classifies isomorphic classes of such. And then my main example, I don't think I will be able to talk about that on tomorrow, so you may miss it if you will. But I will show you how all of this works to give rise to a quite remarkable family of algebras of chiral differential operators on a simple algebra, simple algebraic.
Is a manifold is simply connected?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Other questions? No. Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks again.